Thank you everyone for coming. So today we have Maaike and Maaike, who leads a progressive industrial design studio in San Francisco, and Swan as a design laboratory where they both work independently and with clients to create new opportunities through products, tech, furniture, environments, and transportation. Their collaborations include work with Google, Headspace, Steelcase, Artifort, Incase, Belkin, Xbox, Haworth, and the city of San Francisco. It's really great to have them here today, and I'll just say on behalf of the students and other faculty and staff here, we're really grateful that you guys could make the trip out to speak with us. And yeah, so go ahead whenever you're ready.
I feel like we should give you guys an applause because we've gotten a tour of the campus and gotten to see some of the work of the students. And we're really impressed, so it's really inspiring. So, thank you. So, first of all, Micah's name is pronounced Maaike. A lot of people don't get that, but just wanted to get that out of the way. We're going to talk a little bit about our studio and about our process. We wanted to break down into this theme of seeking and finding. And when you've been working in the field for a while, we found there's different sort of eras you go through. And there's different periods of our lives when we're seeking something different and we're finding something different. So we kind of wanted to show you a little bit of our history and what we were actually seeking and what we were actually finding along the way, because I think that's probably resonates with you at different stages of your journey as you move forward. So we'll just start with chapter one. All right, so our first chapter started, when we were coming out of school, and even before that, we were both seeking possibilities, and we were really optimistic. And what we ended up finding is each other. And so for me, my journey, I grew up in Los Angeles. I was really into anything with wheels, skateboards, cars, RC cars. I sort of invented my own kind of new skateboard and made like off-road vehicles. And I was into surfing and just that whole, that was what I was immersing myself. And then from Maaike.
Yeah, I'm from the Netherlands, and I went to school in Eindhoven, and I was, as a young kid, really, really into Fame. I don't know if anybody knows what that is. It was a TV show that was about this school in New York, Juilliard's, where all these like really talented and highly passionate people do amazing and creative work, and I loved the just the idea of that and the idea of the amount of passion that goes into creating something unique and uniquely beautiful. And that stuck with me. And when I then saw design school, like, this is it. This is exactly what I'm looking for, combining making things with that sort of like drive and passion for beauty. But my upbringing is very, very quiet in a small town in East part of the Netherlands, so there's not that much going on. So the idea of moving to a different country, moving to a place that's very different was also really interesting to me. So I decided to take first an internship in Ohio at a very old college, and then decided to work there. And I believe you guys have met Norio a few weeks ago, but we all worked together at that time and made a road trip here, and we spoke here at Carnegie Mellon about what it was like to just come out of school and start a new job. And it's funny to be here like 30 years later and knowing that Norio was here just recently too. But I just wanted to throw this picture out there for him. But it was a really interesting time where everybody there was young and excited and like really looking for opportunities and looking for ways to have all that passion be manifested in beautiful new experiences.
Yeah, I came out here for my first job too. And that's how we met, actually, in the job interview. Luckily, I was hired. since then, we both decided to move to San Francisco. I've worked at a place called Astro Studios, and it was very lifestyle-driven, lots of energy, lots of music playing in the studio. We built a skate ramp in the studio. It was like a really fun place to work and very lifestyle-driven. One of the projects that I'm most excited about that I worked on there was Xbox 360. And then at the same time, while I was working at Astro, I started a skateboard company that was based on this concept that my friend Peter Chapman and I developed together during school, and we brought it to the market and started the company, and we're selling the skateboards. So I had that sort of like side project at the time.
I ended up going to work for Lunar Design for about 8 years. These are some of the projects that I worked on there. Kind of an interesting time where I sort of like doing a lot of technology and finding ways to bring that technology into the home, connecting everybody with technology. A lot of technology was sort of like for professional environments or medical environments, but there was like a lot of attempt at how do we actually make, you know, technology really useful and with color, so it can be more fit. More inviting so that different audiences will be interested in trying some of these technologies that were developed for more professional applications, so how can we bring that scope into a wider audience. After work though, we spent a lot of time doing our own projects just because we couldn't sort of have enough outlet in our daily projects. And the projects that we did after work were much more about creativity and just experimenting and building things by hand, and that was like important to us to just be able to, you know, have an outlet for that sort of creative expression.
So we built hanging mobiles, candles, posters, screens, jewelry. Just like materials that we were interested in experimenting with, that's just what we gravitated towards.
Some of it we gave away, some of it we started selling in little, you know, galleries in the area, and we really enjoyed the connection with, you know, local communities and engaging with people in different ways.
So at that point we started to realize that we really liked working together, even though we were working in different companies at the time. We sort of felt this pull that we wanted to work on more and more projects together. So that brings us to the next chapter. And in this chapter, we're seeking more meaning in our work. We had already done a lot of projects that had gone into production. We had a lot of experience, but we didn't necessarily feel like those projects were representing like our true selves. So we really needed to find our own voice.
Yeah, we did this exercise where we collected our combined sort of project portfolio. So this was like about 10 years of work, and we found an image that represented all these projects that we had done at that time and put it together in one page and sort of reflected on those for a little while and sort of asked ourselves some questions like, how many of these are actually still in production? When in production?
Yeah.
And there was only 65 of all that work that we had done in consultancy that actually went into production and out of the market. And then we asked ourselves,
how many were still in production?
At that time.
At that time, 10 years later.
10 years later, there was 10 still in the market. And out of those, you know, which ones do we actually still really like, that we're really proud of, and you know, feel that there was something that really connected with us? And there was only 5. And from that, you know, that exercise, we really sort of understood, like, well, why are these 5 important to us? And the sort of commonalities were either if they're self-initiated somehow, like we had a lot of like skin in the game almost, and also if there was a really great synergy between the client and us, and we had input as to maybe, you know, a bigger input than just like a styling exercise, or just like, coming for a very, you know, small part of that process of developing products. And learning that actually gave us like the foundation of, okay, we're gonna need to create a whole new portfolio, because there's not much that we would be able to show that we'd be excited to approach new clients with. So we have to really think about, okay, maybe we need to develop more projects ourselves so that we can reach out to maybe companies and people that resonated more with what we wanted to do.
Another part about quitting our jobs.
Oh yeah, we did that too.
So we both quit our jobs at that time, yeah. And we said, okay, this is a full reset, and we started our studio, and that was 2005.
So we had two rules that first year, and that was that we were not going to take on any clients, and that we were not going to make any money, but just focus on developing that portfolio, working on projects that seemed interesting to us, so that we would have almost like a new voice to connect with the outside world.
And the way I kind of think about this now is like, it's almost like a, when you want to move forward, it's almost like a bow and arrow, like you have to pull back and create tension in order to like get the energy to like propel yourself forward. And this sort of 1 year was like that, like creating tension. It may seem counterintuitive to like quit your job and not want any money or clients, but to us it was like a way of building up that energy.
Yeah, so this was, we rented this house, and so we had a studio in our house at the time, and so the living room was taken over by our work area. We had a little garage downstairs that we had set up a workshop. And so we developed these product ideas, we worked on projects that were interesting to us, so we did furniture, we did soft goods, we did jewelry more, we did artful projects, just to learn new materials, new processes, and then hopefully come up with product ideas that we then could
Yeah, it was pretty great. Like we had, you know, both quit our jobs. Like, what could go wrong?
So very soon we had to figure out a way to move our studio out of the house because that was just not working. So we found ourselves a little storefront in San Francisco, and that was all really great until this happened. It was like Maaike, our daughter, was born. But just to kind of show you what the inside of our studio kind of looked like, we did a lot of experimentation, model making. It was pretty rough and pretty experimental at some times. But like, I don't really know where this is going or what to do with this. But it's, some of these experiments we developed pretty far into prototypes.
So we'll show you a few projects that we worked on.
Yeah, so this is we decided to do a chair for in public spaces. And we have never done any upholstery before or worked. We have done some chairs, but not sort of like to the level where we wanted to take it. So it started off with asking ourselves actually this question of like, you know, if you know, workspaces, the cubicles were going out, the offices were going to be much more open and public. A chair in that space, what could that function, and where does then the furniture sort of end, and where does architecture begin, and where does architecture and furniture begin? So we experimented with this feeling of more enclosed spaces. And it felt to us like a lot like being a kid, and I don't know if you ever had appliances sent to your household and your parents were like, here, play with boxes. And that feeling of play and that scale and being in these big cardboard boxes was just so fun to us as kids. So that feeling we're trying to emulate in a form. And so what could we also take away from that form so that you can still feel connected to your environments, but also have that sort of like really comfortable, interesting scale of some walls and ceiling.
And this kind of illustrates like a lot of our process is really experimental and go through a lot of iterations, you know, from like the basic, like this is a box, to like what can we take away? And then we get really detailed into like how all of the forms sort of like flow together. And we kind of like distill everything down so that the concept is still there and everything sort of feels right. It's kind of an intuitive process, but it's something that's always been in all the work we do, that sort of like distilling things down to where the simplest version. And then we go through like, the process of prototyping.
So this was a way for us to build something in our shop to quickly get a sense of ergonomics and, you know, do you hit your head on that canopy as you go in and out of that chair? Will it actually work? And we, you know, have to work on the lean of the chair a little bit to get that to be just right. And then we took, you know, once we felt like, yeah, this is the proportion is right, ergonomics are right, we dove deeper into upholstery and what that meant to get the chair to that level. And we worked it to the point where we had this actual working prototype.
And so this is all like starting from this first year of like not having any clients and doing all of these projects like self-initiated. But eventually, like a lot of the work we did that year got picked up by different companies. So we didn't do it just to like keep it for ourselves. We wanted to still have these projects like see the light of day, but this one ended up getting picked up by Haworth, and it's still sold to this day. And it was about showing this prototype at ICFF 1 year, and we ended up, you know, it took a few years, but we ended up releasing Haworth. And this is like our kids, you know, around the time when we were doing this project, and then this is how old they were when it was out.
Yeah, so that was like 2005 when we developed it, and then what was that, 2011 when it finally went into production?
Yeah, so sometimes it takes patience and time.
Another project is this bookshelf project that we did, which was it started with the question of what if a bookshelf comes with books, and what should those books then be? Normally, like, you know, shelving has like a certain amount of function that it has, but when you say, well, it's good, what if it actually ships with books? Like, what is this whole concept now? What is this whole product? And also, depending on what you put on that bookshelf and how that's curated, it has a completely different meaning. So once we decided like what kind of books would you actually consider collecting or putting together, curating them together to be shipped together with the shelf, we decided on looking into shipping it with all the religious texts, because these are all texts that would normally not be on the same shelf. But we thought that that would actually create a really interesting dialogue and question, and therefore almost like a statement. So we made about 50 of these, had them machined, and these were sold by a company up in Sacramento that made furniture and some artful furniture pieces. And they sold them for us, and they also sold them.
So this is sort of example of like, these are projects that this one in particular wouldn't happen like in an industrial design studio normally. And so it was really our quest to like find meaning in our work and try to like push into different areas than you know we have. And that was the great thing about having our own studio and our own voice and just being able to take directions that you find interesting.
So this was a poster that we did for the show, the ICFF show in New York. And that shows really the projects that we did in that first year. Some laptop storage, carrying cases, a bookshelf, hanging mobiles under a chair. And that was actually a great way to connect out in the world and show who we are, what we do, and from that we started having some clients and projects.
So one of our first clients, strangely enough, was Google. And at the time, Google was just a search engine. Just like Yahoo, it was just a website, really. And it was a strange meeting. We met with this mysterious company. They didn't say who they were. And we left the meeting still not knowing who they were, and then got an email back later saying, we're Google, and we want to hire you guys to design our first phone. And
and we had conversations like, I don't know if they're ready for doing technology again. It's exactly what we been trying to avoid for years. It's like even a company that would know how to do hardware, because they're a software company. Sounds really stressful. but we decided to, why not? Be interesting to see, what that could be. We were intrigued with the sort of potential, that open-ended potential of, well, they had never done hardware before, what could they do? So we decided to take on the project. And this is sort of an example of like how we started to think about it. This is what their competitors were like, and just like all these buttons and features and complexity. But Google is just about the fastest way to do a search. And we wanted to emulate that into a hardware experience by having just pull on screen and preferably no buttons, so that everything would be touch. It's just how
But this was before iPhone.
And they actually pushed us really hard to go towards the QWERTY interface, where the screen would slide away and there would be the cool keyboards exposed. But this is really where we wanted it to be, like, experience. But unfortunately, I got pushed really hard because it was faster. A millisecond of search was important
for them. So other clients we had at the time, Incase, we did soft goods, which we had never really done before, so we really were exploring a lot of new territory. We did a whole series of luggage for them, that's actually a lot of it's still available. And then in addition, we did completely independent work that wasn't really commercial, that was just purely to explore our own interests. In this case, we wanted to explore the future of automotive design and the future of cars. And this was like in 2009, which was a while ago. And this sort of also shows sort of our process. And we like to approach things from a lot of different angles. We do a lot of talking, we do a lot of brainstorming, and then we do a lot of experiments. So this page kind of just shows like asking a lot of questions, kind of trying to organize ideas, doing some like really like abstract visualization of what the driving or riding experience could be like, looking at how cars are all similar, how could we take the driving part of the car away and only keep the passenger and riding part of the car, and then looking at like how people can like sit in a car if there's no more driving, and what kind of postures does that could that support. And so we basically wanted to design a car that was like taking, you walk out of an architectural experience of your home, and you walk into another architectural experience that just happens to be smaller. And this was all new at the time, like for us, there really wasn't much driverless, there wasn't any talk of it or in terms of like a design vision. it was mostly just technology vision of what this could be. So it was really fun to like, it was almost like uncharted territory for design. So we just created this vision and then we published it and started a lot of interesting conversations. You know, it was pretty controversial actually at the time. People, it still, you know, still does have, it still is in that nature sometimes, but it was really fun to just start this conversation and like try to uncover what that experience could be like. So this was like visualizing what a community could be like. And then soon after that, this happened. Like we ended up becoming a part of Google. And so that was a little bit abrupt, and it wasn't something we planned, but we ended up all of a sudden like inside of Google. And so then that started a whole new chapter for us.
Yeah, I mean, we really were interested in like the impact that we could have with joining a larger company. We had peeked a little bit in the company and see how they worked and how projects were being developed. And they talked to us about their aspirations to do a lot more hardware, and that was very positive. So why not? And so we've worked on just an Internet of Things project. This was like a music player that terribly flopped, which was also a really good experience. And other devices that would sort of be accompanying, you know, cell phone experiences.
The really fun part was like trying to bring a design voice to Google. And it was kind of like open game because like they were asking us to do it, and we decided to really like go into like elemental shapes, elemental like meaning like just reducing things down to their simplest possible form, and we were just really gravitating towards the basic shapes, so spheres, cubes, like flat circles, and basically turning hardware project or products into these like very elemental pieces.
I think that also came with like, you know, software can start to carry heavier load and complexity, and so devices could be stripped more from their complexity. And we were really interested in exploring that sort of that end state. You know, what if all of the buttons are gone and we don't have a lot of interaction, but we still, you know, what still needs to be there, if we can be there. But most of the interactions can happen on screen.
And we were asked to lead the Google Android phone and tablet industrial design. So we started an industrial design team just for phones and tablets. And we hired a bunch of people and created a whole team around creating like Google's first in-house designed phones and tablets.
And that quickly became a much more complex endeavor because when you develop new hardware, then also the software experience is at its infancy. So there was a lot of collaborative effort to, you know, almost have a similar voice between the hardware and the software experience. And so we were collaborating with their UX team and graphic design team to sort of deliver, you know, the next year's voice. A lot of that work was working with them, like what's the ideal, you know, screen size, what's the ideal thickness, what's the ideal components. And, so we were able to get early on in the process to sort of set the parameters of what the components of the hardware should have, and then do models and prototypes to envision what that experience could look like, and then bring that package to the manufacturers and say, this is what Google is looking for their next software experience, hardware experience. Can you build it, or can you develop an industry, or can you bring that to life?
What was really fun was like the scale of this, because we could you know, we had a lot of resources available to like try a lot of things. So if you wanted to see 20 models or something, we could. You can kind of see like some of these tablets, like just trying, you know, appearance models of like a lot of kind of variations. But you're able to actually hold things in your hand. And when you're making products that are going to be sold at that scale, it's important to have, you know, a lot of iterations to try to get things right. We worked on some early smartwatch concepts, and again, just like experimenting and trying all kinds of different variations. We sort of like took our normal process and just added a bunch of resources to it that let us like scale it up to be, you know, broader. Hardware has pointed their sort of earnings in their, when they would talk to their annual investors report, they would have to talk about hardware as a line item because of this device. And then after a couple of years of doing phones and tablets, we were a little bit like feeling our desire for variety was starting to kick in. And it was kind of like, oh, do you want to do a third year of phones and tablets? And we started to look around at Google to just see what else was going on. And we had some great conversations with Google X, and we ended up joining Google X. Our team that we built up at Android ended up, you know, continuing to grow, and they're now, they evolved into the Pixel team that's doing Pixel phones. Obviously a whole different group of people. Some of them are still there. But we went to X, and we went from designing phones to now designing all kinds of.
Yeah, so we were a centralized team that would support all their, what they call bets. So they're all these projects that try to tackle really, really big problems. The top is an energy kite, so it's the idea of generating energy on a large scale. So this is was sort of envisioned as like an alternative to windmills and a way to get more efficient harvesting of wind energy, which in essence is like a, you know, ground station with this drone-like ring that's the scale of a 737 ring that would be tethered to that ground station. And they made it to the point of an actual flying prototype on Hawaii, I believe. But that project is unfortunately canceled. But our responsibility sometimes was to do brainstorm sessions with that team and to envision what the experience is like from people in real life. And what does it look like? Is that something that you would want in your neighborhood? And that's something that, you know, a lot of the technologists aren't really thinking about or really have much experience with. For us, it was a really fun way to visualize what the experience of the end state could look like and brainstorm with them to figure out ways to simplify it, to make it more appealing, to make it just something that looks something more. We also did really, really small things, working on glucose monitoring stickers for type 1 and type 2 diabetes.
We worked on drone delivery, on driverless cars a little bit. It was just like a whole variety of really interesting projects. One of them was like advanced VR. And this was originally a Google X project, and you know we were really looking at like experimental versions of VR, and like we were really pushing all the different technical aspects. And so we were there to try to like create a vision for what the actual product would be based on the technology. So we felt a little overwhelming at times, as you can see. But we had a great team, and we ended up shipping Google's first head-mounted, like, wearable VR product.
So this was really almost like an accessory to their phone, so it's a phone-based VR system. So all the lenses, it's really simple. It's like, I don't know if you've seen Google Cardboard, but it's an evolution of that, but something that would be more comfortable for you to wear for longer time.
So we took a lot of what we learned doing soft goods, and we wanted to make something that you wear actually be soft, like a wearable product. And all the other VR devices that come were like rigid plastic. And so, to their credit, like, their hardware team had not done soft goods based products before, and we helped guide them a bit, but we ended up getting help from like some manufacturers that could really like figure out how to make things work. So we would do things like this, where we would like visualize what the construction could be, you know, which parts are soft, which parts are hard, and then engage like both the hardware manufacturer and like a soft goods manufacturer, and then try to like bring those together. And this was all done, this product from conception to shipping was like less than a year, which is really fast for a product of this type.
So at that time, we really started to feel kind of uncomfortable again, because we had been at Google for about 4.5 years, and it also felt kind of that we were losing our sort of creative identity, our passion for doing a lot of different things, exploring new territories, and at Google we sort of get locked into these product categories or even these teams, which constantly sort of started to feel uncomfortable to us and not really true to our identity in this space. So we decided to leave and start our own company again. And so this is chapter 4, seeking our creative freedom again.
That's the chapter we're in now.
Yes. And for us, it's really finding our playground. So that what that meant is finding our consultancy space again, finding our clients again, finding our voice again. So we've been fortunate in doing some more work in furniture space, because it's, continues to be really interesting. And sometimes clients approach us and it sounds really unique, or it's something that sparks our curiosity. We did some work for a company in Holland that does furniture. We did this sort of line of hoops and tables and on the space. And we did the laptop table for lounge spaces with them. We've also formed like an interesting partnership with a company up in the Seattle area. It's an office furniture company, and we did like a line with them a while back, but they've asked us to refresh it and to think of what's important in the current workspace. And we developed this line that's all based on a very lightweight and very flexible line of tables that is thinking about softening that workspace to allow people to work together more, to bring people together in the place. And we noticed that a lot of the traditional forms are very rectilinear, and really curious about pushing for the more softer forms that would allow people to join together more.
So this whole line was just designed around bringing people together. This was like post-COVID. That's actually sort of during COVID, but like the idea of like, how do we bring people together? And if you're going to the office, like, why go if not to work with other people? So this is just like some more process. The CEO of the company is there under the table. He gets really hands on, and like these are the kind of collaborations that we really love. When like we're working directly with like a passionate team, and we just really have a good rapport. And so that's the sort of thing that in our new version of our studio, that's really when we take on a project, is when we feel that relationship is really there. And when the subject matter is really fun and exciting for us. So this turned into like this whole line of products that are all out. It's a whole line of tables all around the room together. And then another sort of like example of project that in our new version of our studio that we're really attracted to is something that brings together a lot of different areas that we're interested in.
Yeah, so this is Headspace. They asked us if we could develop a physical sort of manifestation of their software experience. So Headspace is a meditation app, the founders asked us, like, can you develop some sort of experience or furniture or something like that that allow people to experience and try our software experience without them having to download it. So at that time got so many asks from companies and actually educators to form relationships so that, because they saw the benefit, or the companies and the educators saw the benefit of their application, but they basically saw a disconnect of people actually wanting to try it. So that's why they asked, like, is there something we can build that allow people to just step into it and just try it without them having to download it on their own phone? So we developed this sort of furniture piece with them that has an electronic module in it and speakers. So we could just walk right into it and press a button, and there's actually three buttons in that experience. And this one says relax, this one says refresh, and that one focus. And under each button there's four different meditations, so you could cycle through it if you want to. So times three, that's 12 meditation experiences under that. And that's basically sufficient for a lot of people to just give it a try.
And we wanted to really get this feeling of like you step into this piece of furniture and you sort of get taken into a different place. And this was like a really good example of like a project that like combines a lot of the things that we're interested in, like furniture, sort of experience, and like mindfulness, and then electronics. I mean, these are things that don't always come together very often in projects. A really fun project for us. And that's it. That's our kind of our playground, and that's what we really enjoy, like having our studio. We've had some like events there, and we always like to invite people over. So if you're ever in San Francisco, feel free to drop one by or give us a call. And I'm happy to do it. So we're happy to answer any questions that you have. Yes.
When you were in your studio after quitting your jobs, how were you able to access like tools? Did you use a makerspace, or did you like buy tools for like, I don't know, I think I saw a picture of metal pieces cut out and like machines like that. Like, how do you find that?
So you're asking like when we were in our studio, how are we able to access tools to make things in the studio we have now?
Yeah, or is it the same one at the time when you first quit your job?
No, it's a new one now. But yeah, we've always had a lot of tools. We've had a shop in our studio always. It's just a big part of what we do. We mostly use our shop to make prototypes that prototypes that test out a certain thing, like whether it's ergonomics or scale. for electronic projects or smaller projects, we 3D print a lot, either in our own studio or we outsource that sometimes. But we're always making things with, like, a lot of times plywood, you know, screws, hot glue, foam core. It's like really to get things like kind of roughed out.
It's very similar to what we saw today at the tour, actually. What you have available to you is, you know, well, you have more sophisticated things than you have in a little shop. Yes?
How exactly did y'all come up with, like, personal projects and, like, arrange and organize a purpose to find your direction?
Really question, especially because, you know, us having such different backgrounds, it's really hard to decide because we come at it from so many different perspectives most of the time. But that's why there's a lot of dialogue, either brainstormed or we set ourselves like some sort of goal. If we want to, you know, what kind of projects are we want to work on, and then it's the dialogue of, like, you know, how do we approach it, like, focus be, and do a brainstorm session, many twists and turns later. We do some random mock-ups, and you know, that's kind of how we start. But it's a lot of dialogue, a lot of talking.
I was wondering in the very beginning, I mean, maybe not the very beginning, but in your first studio, how did you get yourself out there and have your experimental, or not experimental, but your passion projects get recognized so that you could start getting clients and making money? How did you go about making that transition and the approach?
So how do we get our work out there and noticed? And,
yeah.
It was actually pretty deliberate, because it's something we had to think about, because the worst thing is if you just do a project and you really like it, but it's just, you don't know where it's going to go or where to show it. But we started to do little things, like we would do like little talks, we made a website that was like fun and kind of different. We just started with our friends, like sent stuff to our friends, and we started to build up like bigger and bigger, like mailing, like emailing lists at the time. And then we started to send stuff out to like magazines at the time or like blogs. And then we just sort of got lucky sometimes, like something would get picked up, just because that's the nice thing about design is if it has like that energy, like it doesn't matter the scale of the publication, they want to publish it. So it is really, like, it's hard, but it's actually also in some ways really easy, because we make something that has that spark to it, and once people see it, it might, you know, it might really spread. And so that happened a few times in some of our projects. And then we get to know more people to send stuff to. And yeah, after a while it would be like we would just send a new project out to just a couple of different blogs, and then they would like publish it the next day and it would just be out there. So it became...
I mean, it's also different because at that time blogs and websites were very eager to get content and they were really kind of curious. Whereas now it's much more about self-publicizing your work and working on your Instagram and all that. So times have changed. It's still something that we're still trying to figure out too. Like how does that work and how do you stay connected with the people that care about your work and are interested in what you do? And I mean, the other thing that really probably pretty fundamental for us doing more furniture work was to show at ICFF in New York. That attracts so many people and there's so many eyes that see your work at the time. It's a big undertaking to do that, but really there's a lot of designers that go there and there's a lot of companies that really just have inspiration and to
I was wondering, because at the beginning you said that there were like five projects that were still in production that you still like really connect with, and I was wondering like if you could tell us a bit more about those projects and what it is about them that you think like makes you still connect with them after all this time.
I don't know if we still connect with them after the next 10 years, but maybe we do. So I think what those projects were, well, I know like one of them was a skateboard that I had worked on, and that was, you know, my personal project that I worked on with my friend, and that had so much, it created so much satisfaction to know that, you know, I started this thing and invented it with my friend and like took it all the way. So that's why it was like, that's why I still liked it. I think there were some projects that we had started just on our own, like some hanging mobiles that were more decorative. But again, it was that feeling of like, that we did this like from scratch, and nobody asked us to do this. We just thought this should exist. And it still sort of held up over 10 years. That's the thing about the design quality too, is like, if you still like it much later, like years and years later, then it means that something about it, at least to me, like was sort of right. And we could see after 10 years, we could see which things didn't do that. And a lot of times the things that didn't do that were things that were maybe trendy, or it was like a look that was like happening at the time, or an idea that was just gonna come and go. Yeah, it was almost more useful to see what didn't last and what we really weren't resonating with. Almost, it was almost more important to see that, because then we could kind of avoid those things. Another thing that made things sort of not fall into that category of things we still liked was when they were compromised. And that happened a lot in consulting at the time, when like you're kind of a service if you're a consulting firm. You can approach your business as a service, and if you're a service and the client is asking you to do something, then you can choose to do exactly what they're asking for. And maybe at the time we were a little bit younger, we were a little bit like more oriented towards pleasing the client. But in retrospect, those were times when we should have probably pushed back and not compromised things. And so like, those compromises really show in the end product. Does that help?
Yeah.
Could you all talk a little bit about being in a partnership, and like, do you all move as a unit? Do you split up the work? Work-life
balance,
just anything about
being together.
Advice?
Don't do it.
Want
to
drink?
we share the passion for what we do, and there's like a, you know, ultimately the work that we do decide to work on together, and that's, we have a lot of synergy about. It turns out to something that we really value and we appreciate and love. And, so that's sort of the energy that we draw from a lot. But when it comes to how do we split up the work, it really depends. Depends on what we have going on. Depends on our interests. Levels a little bit different sometimes in the
context. Yeah, for example, sometimes like what we'll do is we'll brainstorm, and then whichever project like each of us is excited about, we'll go and like do some drawings, do some CAD like experiments, and then we'll come back, and then sometimes we'll see something in each other's work and we'll say, oh, like that sketch that you did, like I really like this, and Maaike may not even have seen that in that sketch. And then I'll take it and I'll put it into CAD and like try something. And it sort of like goes back and forth. And we try to like find little jewels in each other's work and just like try to just do it, whatever we can to bring them up.
Yes. Your work is just terrific. I'm sure you get tons of resumes for internships and. what do you see in a portfolio that makes you stop and say this is different than a typical portfolio?
That's a good question. It's getting to know the person through the types of projects that they've chosen to do. It's seeing, you know, skills, just, you know, their eye for sort of presenting and explaining the work, the skill of course making the models and the photography and the renderings, and that's really important. But it's many times like the interesting story or the interesting project that they decided to take on that's really personal, and you can see that, and you can see the passion, and it just makes it stand out.
Yeah, I think also, like, a lot of times we'll look at it and say, is this something that we would feel comfortable presenting? Like, is this the level? We don't ask ourselves that out loud, but when you see work that's like not something you would present yourself, then it feels like you would have to be teaching somebody a lot. Whereas if someone is like goes really deep into something, wow, I've never seen someone do so many experiments with lighting or with like a chair or with wood or whatever it is, when they went really deep, then they're actually more experts on that subject than we are. And so it's exciting to just see somebody like build that excitement and energy and skill towards something, whether it's models or renderings or whatever. It doesn't have to be everything, but like just to see someone find that passion for what they do. And when we were at Google, we were hiring people that were maybe not even the right fit for what the kind of work that we were doing. There was one person that we hired whose website was like really poetic, and it was his portfolio was like just very emotional, poetic, and the work we were doing was like very technical and like engineering heavy, and it felt like that person needed to, like, I don't know, it's not like his work matched what we were doing at the time, but it felt like that work needed to come and influence the world where we were living. So, but if another person's portfolio might be very technical, and they would also be a fit. So it's a little bit more about the fit, too. It's not always about, you know, is it good or bad? It's also the fit of who you're sending your work to.
We have time for one more question. Anyone has a question? Go ahead.
Hey, first, thank you for your sharing today. And I come from the technology background, and I'm interested in how the designer should cooperate with the engineer.
Mm.
And for example, when you design the first Google form, I think the main reason you didn't, you still have the keyboard on the phone is because the operating system is not mature enough in the time.
Yeah, I think the engineer request, like how do designers collaborate with engineers question, like that's something that took us a really long time to figure out. And I think I would also like, I give that advice of like work with as many different types of disciplines as you can, especially like when you're in school too, just to like get to know how other disciplines think. Because engineering and design can be a little bit of a difficult relationship to navigate. And I feel like over our years at Google, we actually got to be pretty good at it. But in the beginning, we weren't that good at it. And it turned out that there were like little tricks. And one of the tricks was, if you're asking someone to do something, to really understand their perspective. Like, if they're saying no, find out why, and then help to make it so that their concerns are addressed. So, and the biggest trick we learned was, well, let's do two versions. Let's do one that's conservative, that you can, you're not gonna get in trouble, you're not gonna cause the product to not work. Let's do that, we're happy to support that. But let's also do another one that pushes the envelope a little bit, and let's see if that one works as well. And so then you're putting that engineer in a position to succeed. And also, they might get excited about the other version too. And then it helps you both to like create this sort of synergy together. I think the Google, the keyboard example, that's a really good point. Like, it's not just a design decision of if you're going to have a keyboard or not. It's based on the whole software stack up and the usability and all of that. So,
I think what we thought was that Google was website, and it's all, it was sort of designed to do that, but there's actually so much metrics and speed-driven decisions behind that website that we didn't know that at the time. And so their mode was all about speed, like how to type in something and how can you do that in the fastest way to get your search result in the fastest possible way. And they tested if people did the type with touch type versus like actual key, that was like a millisecond faster, and that's why they wanted that feature, because that was like the top level metric for success. And so we learned, that was like that important to them.
Thank you, very important. Well, thank you all.
Thank you.